This is Grace Notes. I'm Alan Button, and our guest today is Laura Layton. Laura is a social worker, having gotten a master's degree at the University of Illinois in social work. She's a mother and grandmother of three, and we'll fill in some of the gaps as we go along. Laura, welcome.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Let's start, if we could, by having you tell us a little bit about what you do as a social worker. And I might add, by the way, that Laura has background in social work in a number of different places, but has been a resident now of North Carolina almost 6 years.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us what you do.
Well, I work in a dialysis clinic, addressing the needs of chronically ill folks, helping them adjust to treatment, educating them on their disease process.
Dialysis, of course, we're talking kidneys.
Kidney, right? Dialysis, yeah. Mm-hmm. And just work with the adjustment process and address any unmet needs they might have, things that I can plug in for them in the community, give them emotional support, explore their families, and just try to get as many supports in place as I can for them to have a life where they thrive instead of just become a disease.
You were telling me before we came into the studio that it's actually a legal requirement that dialysis patients have a social worker assigned to them. Have I got that right?
Yeah, it's a mandate by the rules that govern dialysis through the CMS, which is the Center for Medicare and Medicaid, which if you take Medicare or Medicaid payments, then you have certain guidelines that you have to follow, and having a social worker and a dietitian are two of the requirements.
And I assume part of that is grounded on the recognition that dialysis patients have common issues emotionally, psychologically, socially, family-wise.
Absolutely. I mean, I have some patients that have known they have had kidney disease for years and years and years and still are very much in denial about the fact that they have to go on dialysis. I also have patients that didn't know they were ill at all and all of a sudden couldn't breathe, were really fatigued, go to the hospital, and they're told they have kidney disease and need to start dialysis. So it's quite a shock. Mm. When you find out that you have to go on dialysis, it's really a life-altering treatment.
What's the usual regimen for somebody on dialysis?
Folks that are getting treatments in center come in 3 days a week, either Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, or Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday. They also have, I have patients that do treatments at home, which there are two different kinds of dialysis they can do at home, and they do it 5 or 6 days a week. So it varies a little bit about the situation. If you don't have a support person, then you'll usually come in center. But if you have somebody who can assist you with the treatments at home, then home treatments are great for those folks.
And when you say come into center, you mean the location?
Yes,
at which
dialysis
the machinery, the equipment, mm-hmm, is located.
Most of them are there 4 hours each treatment, so they're with us 12 hours a week.
Well, what sorts of issues do you see? What kinds of things do you deal with these patients?
A lot of times anxiety. Some people are bothered by the noise of the machine. Some people are bothered by the amount of people in the room. Some people are worried about needles because, of course, they are cannulated with 2 needles every day if they have a permanent access. Some people are worried about money. People are worried about losing their jobs. People are worried about being able to care for their families. So there's a lot of things that can cause anxiety in somebody who has been diagnosed.
I'd like to come back in a little bit to some of the specifics about what you do and so on. But let me have you, at this point, tell us how you got into social work.
Well, I was in college, and I was a business major. And
This was in Illinois.
In Illinois. That's where I was raised. And during the summer, my father was diagnosed with cancer. At the same time, my father-in-law had a massive heart attack and was in a different city in Illinois, having triple bypass heart surgery. So I spent a lot of time in hospital rooms all summer. I dropped out of college, and I would sometimes stay with my father for days. And I found myself, you know, just taking a break, going out in the hall, and I would visit with other people, and they would be so distraught. And I was just able to provide some support to them and some comfort to them. And I thought, maybe this is what I need to figure out how to do as a living. Because I got a lot more enjoyment out of being able to bring some brightness to somebody's life than doing my economics.
I assume that that was some pretty special time with your dad.
Huh? Yeah, it was. Unfortunately, by the time he was diagnosed, he only lived about 6 weeks. So I spent as much time as I could with him.
Well, tell us about this first song that you've identified, because I know it, based on what you were telling me, it relates to your dad, Wings of a Dove.
Yes, it was a song that my dad often sang as a solo in church. He sang in the church choir every week. He was very involved with his church, and a song that he very much believed in, and it just is fond memories for me.
Well, let's hear the song, Wings of a Dove, by Ferlin Husky.
On the wings of a snow-white dove, he sends his pure, sweet love.
Wings of a dove.
On the wings of a dove.
Wings of a dove.
On the wings of a dove.
Wings of a dove.
That was Wings of a Dove by Ferlin Husky, which, by the way, and you may know this, Laura, has been covered by a number of artists, including Loretta Lynn, Dolly Parton, Ricky Skaggs, Tammy Wynette. Great history there. And I'm reminded in listening to the lyrics about the, well, the account in Genesis of the dove that made its way to Noah, right there in the middle of the song. If you're just joining us, our guest today is Laura Layton. Laura is a social worker focusing at this point on dialysis patients. But Laura, I understand you've got some significant social work background outside of dialysis. Tell us about it. Where to start, right?
Yeah, I've been doing it a long time. And I guess that's kind of the good thing about social work. You can go a lot of different directions. And actually, I had a professor in college and graduate school that said, people never really know what a social worker is. You know, social work doesn't have any teeth. You go to a dentist, you know you're going to get your teeth worked on, but what do social workers really do? And kind of the answer is a lot of things, everything. I have worked in child welfare. I have worked in child welfare abuse investigations. I've worked in child welfare adoptions. I did elder abuse investigations and interventions for quite some time. I worked for the state of Illinois as a professional guardian for folks that didn't have anybody to advocate for them. They didn't have any family or anyone that was able to make decisions for them. I have worked in shelters for runaway kids. I have worked in domestic violence shelters, working with women and families, trying to find escape plans or safety plans when they do go back. I think that's the most of it.
It sounds like the list could go on. Is there any particular arena that you found especially satisfying?
I actually loved being a guardian. You know, they were...
strikes me that that might be one of the toughest roles that you just listed there.
It pulls you in a lot of direction because I was in charge of about 120 people that lived across 7 counties in Illinois, and I had to make all their decisions for them. They weren't able to make decisions, so I would get calls all day long about so-and-so slipped out of her wheelchair, or so-and-so has a cut on her left hand, what should we do? You know, so I would have to give them direction as to where to go. I also had to make really tough decisions like taking away life support. If there really was no hope available. I got to make exciting decisions, though, like organ donation. So that was a good thing. And the younger, more healthy folks that I got to see were always very excited to see me because nobody else came to see them. They didn't have family. I did try to locate a lot of family members, and I actually was successful in a few cases and drove my client to see their family. One guy had not seen his mother in 30 years, and we actually found her just about in time. She was really not in good health and was nearing death.
With those many years of experience and interactions with so many different people, how do you deal with compassion fatigue?
I laugh a lot. Uh-huh. And I just have always had sort of the outlook just to find joy in everything or anything, you know, a nice cold bottle of water, uh-huh. you know, something goofy my grandkids have said or done, nature. I've also had counseling at times when things were really tough with my different occupations, you know, to sort of process through some of those events that come up professionally. But mostly I just have a great sense of humor.
You find things to laugh about.
I do.
To smile about.
Absolutely.
I understand from what I've heard outside the studio that you regularly go above and beyond, too. Is there any particular circumstance that comes to mind that maybe you could give us an example of that?
Well, I have done things like patients who did not want to go to the hospital. I would tell them, I will follow them to the hospital. And I would stay at the emergency room with them until they could figure out what was going on with them and either admit them or let them go home for the evening.
And this is not part of your job description.
No. No, the last time I did it, I didn't get home until 10:30 at night. But, you know, I've done things like that. I'm really good at begging for other people. Finding ways of getting things for folks that don't have the financial means to get it. I occasionally have had a meal delivery service.
Uh-huh. From your own kitchen?
Yes. Uh-huh. Yeah. Or my daughter's. Uh-huh. My daughter likes to get in on the whole giving as well. She was kind of raised doing that. I raised her volunteering in homeless shelters. And
like mother, like daughter.
Mm-hmm.
I understand, too, that you've got personal experience in the fostering of children. How did that come to be?
That's kind of a sad story, how it came to be, but I think it had a pretty good outcome. I was working in a shelter for runaway kids, and one of the girls left to go to a ball game and did not come back until the next morning. And the social worker who was above me said, well, she didn't follow the rules. She has to face the consequences, and she needs to be isolated to her room, and she needs to be drug tested. And nobody was talking to the kid. You know, she was 16. And so I went up to her room and I talked to her, and she disclosed to me that she had actually been raped by three people that she knew in the high school. So I took her to the hospital, and they did concur that she probably did receive the injury she had from a rape. And the social worker that I was working with just said, well, she's got to suffer the consequences. You know, if she hadn't been there, if she hadn't been with people that she shouldn't have been with, if, so this is the consequence. And I just didn't feel good about that. And so I actually went to the director of the agency and said, this is what's happened. I don't feel good about it. And although he did correct the situation, she was removed from being isolated. I said, you know, I just can't volunteer at a place that doesn't have any more compassion or any more integrity to figure out really what was going on. And so then I thought, well, I'll just foster kids myself. And I took primarily high-risk kids, kids that were chronic runaways, kids that had just gotten out of Department of Corrections. My biggie was parenting kids so that we could keep young mothers and their babies together, and then I would model for them and give them some training.
I don't know about you, but that seems to me that there's a decent segue there to this second song that you've selected. Tell us about it. Imagine by John Lennon.
Well, I like to imagine a world that's more perfect than it is. So I guess that's why that song is near and dear to my heart.
Good segue. That's what I figured you might say. Let's hear it. Imagine by John Lennon.
Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. And the world will live as one.
That was Imagine by John Lennon. His biggest hit. It earned Lennon a Grammy Hall of Fame Award, and in fact, he attributes a significant part of that writing to his wife, Yoko Ono, and she has, since 2017, been recognized as a co-writer. Great song, a regular on our playlist, Laura. If you're just joining us, our guest is Laura Layton, social worker extraordinaire who goes above and beyond. Somehow, Laura, you've mixed your career in with a significant volunteer component, or vice versa, I guess mm-hmm. is maybe the way to say it. I commend you for your heart and your compassion and your perspective. Maybe if we could, let me have you tell us a little bit more about the specifics of what you deal with in dialysis. How many patients do you work with?
Around 80.
And they come in three times a week, you say, on average?
I have 55 that come in three times a week, and the rest of my patients are home dialysis patients.
I see.
And so I don't see them as frequently, but it's all sort of need-driven.
So how much time do you spend with each patient?
I see all of them every time they come in, but that could be a five-minute conversation about how are you doing? What book are you reading? Just showing an interest in them as opposed to them being a patient. And
so when you say it's need-based, is that the term you
use? Well, that's what I say. I mean, if there's an unmet need that really needs to be addressed, certainly I'm going to spend more time finding a solution to that than somebody who's just doing fine.
Uh-huh.
So those would be the shorter conversations, and some people who are extremely depressed or have had a major change in their life, maybe lost their housing, maybe lost their insurance, can't figure out how to get their medications, can't afford their medications, then those are certainly longer conversations and more interventions.
Is there anything about the system, and I'm not exactly sure what to call it, I'll call it the system of providing dialysis, is there anything about the system that you think could be improved upon? I gather it's somewhat institutionalized, but mm-hmm. I also gather that with people like you involved, it can go in a lot of directions in terms of how any individual patient is treated.
It's a pretty finely oiled machine.
Uh-huh.
I mean, they have really done a lot of research and developing programs that will help motivate patients, inform patients, and a lot of times it's the same information but presented in a different way because people learn differently. I think it's important to have all the facets that we have. You know, we have nurses, we have technicians, we have a dietitian that helps them with their diet because it's very restrictive and they need to find alternatives. I think it's important to have a social worker just because when you're diagnosed with something that's going to be lifelong, it can be very emotional and it can be very hard to accept and you have a lot of barriers to overcome. Your life changes dramatically if you've been working 40 hours a week and then all of a sudden, well, you have a part-time job, which is dialysis, 12 hours a week.
Mm-hmm. But generally speaking, then, you feel like things are put together pretty well in terms of providing for the needs of these individuals. Is that fair?
I really do think it is. I think that depending on where you are working in dialysis, sometimes the caseloads get very high. I feel very fortunate to have a lower caseload here in North Carolina where I can spend more time with patients, and a lot of times then I can uncover something that might be coming down the pike and come up with some solutions before it becomes an issue.
Are there ways that non-professionals can be involved on a volunteer basis with patients who have these, whatever needs there may be in the dialysis context?
Well, because of the rights to privacy, it's hard to have anybody actually interact with the patients. But I do have some people that volunteer, and they bring in snacks to put in the lobby for the patients, you know, graham crackers, animal crackers, things that are renal friendly, which makes a big difference in some of these folks' lives, just to have something that they can have a little snack before they get on the bus to go back home or have their family pick them up.
I imagine, yeah, there are all sorts of levels of support or lack of support for particular individuals.
Yeah, there are some people that their families aren't as involved as I wish they were. There are also some individuals that have relocated here and don't really have any family here and end up very ill, and they just don't have many supports in place. So I do try to find things to fill in some gaps. Like, there's a program through Lee County that will do calls to people that are at home to just check on them. There are programs like Meals on Wheels, so that at least they have contact with somebody. If, you know, they deliver their meals, and if they don't answer the phone, then they would always call us. And I do try to have family meetings when I feel like the family is not understanding what the patient is going through. I also work on end-of-life decisions with a lot of people, because unfortunately, a lot of people don't think about advance directives or power of attorney when they're healthy. And if they become too ill, then they may not have the capacity in which to make solid decisions for themselves. And then it's too late to make an advance directive. So I do work on those issues with folks, just to make them aware of what's available to them and why it could be helpful.
Tell us about this third song that you've identified. Do It for the Love.
Well, I love Michael Fronte. I've been a fan of his for a long time. I lived in Oakland, California for many years. And
that's where he's from?
That's where he's from. Mm-hmm. And so I've heard a lot of his music. He's very much a social activist. He's very much into peace and peace on earth. And this song is talking about Do It for the Love. And I think that's why I do what I do. I do it because I love. I don't do it for the money. I don't do it for the honeys. I do it for the love. And my two grandsons love this song too. They call it the honey song, and they belt it out every time I put it on for them.
These are your 4-year-old and 5-year-old
grandson. Yeah. The 12-year-old just rolls his eyes.
So this is the song that rationalizes your change from a business major to a social work major.
That's right.
Well, it's been a treat, Laura, to have you here. Thank you very much
for
being here. And on behalf of all of us here at the station, we wish you well in your continued great work social work arena.
Thank you so much.
Let's hear the song, Do It for the Love, by Michael Fronte and Spearhead.